السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على عبده ومصطفاه سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. وبعد، brothers and sisters, welcome to a new edition of Ask Huda. Our phone numbers are still the 10 phone numbers beginning with air code 0020-100-246-4583. And other number is 002 area code, then 0100-247-2187. Numbers should appear on the screen meanwhile. And the email address is the same, ask@huda.tv. Our Facebook page is www.facebook.com/msalahofficial. Without any further ado, we had a couple of pending questions, and we'll be more than happy to start collecting your valuable calls and concerns. The first pending question is from Umm Abdul Rahman from the United Arab Emirates. She says, is it permissible to pay my zakat to a single woman who doesn't have a husband or children or to support her? Well, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah At-Tawbah, إِنَّمَا الصَّدَقَاتُ لِلْفُقَرَاءِ وَالْمَسَاكِينِ وَالْعَامِلِينَ عَلَيْهَا. The ayah, ayah number 60. And the first two categories cover every person who's poor or needy, whether he or she is single or married with kids or without. So why do you specify a single woman without a husband who does not have children? It doesn't matter. As long as she is poor, then she is eligible to accept your zakah. Of course, it would require some wisdom as how much should you deposit of your zakah money with her versus another person with a big family and who is much more in need. So it is smart to distribute your zakah in a fair fashion. Of course, this woman, if she is poor or needy, is eligible for your zakah. Barakallahu fiki. Sister Hamna had a couple of questions, but the first question is pertaining following a particular madhab. Is it compulsory? No, it is not compulsory to follow a particular madhab. The madhab, as we discussed repeatedly before, are not different sects, rather different understanding in the light of the available evidence of the sound hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which may also explain the ayat via the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So it is not compulsory to follow a Hanafi or a Shafi'i or a Maliki madhab. For the layman, it would be best if you take the fatwa from your local imam whom you trust, or the mufti, or the faqih, a scholar, okay? For specialized people in fiqh who have achieved the level of ijtihad now, when they figure out the opinion of the madhab which they have followed is overwritten, or there is a better opinion in the light of a stronger reference, then they should yield to the stronger opinion. There is no prejudice in Islam but to the truth. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Okay, Farah from United Arab Emirates, assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam, Sheikh.
How are you, sister?
Alhamdulillah, I'm fine. Sheikh, I have three questions.
No.
The first question is relating to the brothers. I just want to understand if this night is only one, so because there is a difference of day and night in so many different parts of the world. So
Sister how can Farah, we know? Unfortunately, your voice is breaking off. It's a very bad connection. I cannot comprehend your question.
Okay, sorry. Is it okay now?
Yes, it is okay now. Go ahead.
Okay, I want to understand when exactly is Laylatul Qadr, when there is a difference of day and night in different parts of the world.
No.
And my second question is, what do we do with food that is like not suitable for consumption? For example, if we put more salt or chili by mistake. And my third question is, if like we are so busy with the household work, we are not able to like properly look after our cleanliness, like say for example during Salah, like you know, like some women they are busy with kids and home, like housework and everything, so they don't look after themselves very well. So Is there salah like accepted in that kind of situation?
Okay. Thank you, Sister Farah. Barakallah feek. Three important questions. The first is pertaining, how do we know that it is Laylatul Qadr since it's a night here and a night somewhere else or a day somewhere else and so on. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Qadr and in Surah Al-Dukhan, إِنَّا أَنزَلْنَهُ فِي لَيْلَةٍ مُبَارَكَةٍ and إِنَّا أَنزَلْنَهُ فِي لَيْلَةَ الْقَدْرِ, which means we have sent it down on a blessed night, on the night of the decree, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam referred to this night as the most blessed night, as it stated in the Quran, لَيْلَةُ الْقَدْرِ خَيْرٌ مِّنْ أَلْفِ شَهْرٍ. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, it is one of the odd nights of the last one-third of Ramadan. So beginning from the 21st night, according to your locality, it may be a day somewhere else, that's fine. Whenever it's a night in your locality, then this is Laylatul Qadr. Whether it is the 21st, 23rd, 25th, 27th, or the 29th. It can be on two different nights in the same month. But according to the more right view, it changes. It is not the same every year. It may be, but it's not necessarily the case that every year on the 23rd or the 27th. This is a more right view. But within the same year, within the same month of Ramadan, if it happens to be in Mecca on the 23rd night of Ramadan, then in the US it's going to be on the 23rd night of Ramadan, in Russia and in China, all over the world. Whenever it is night in this place. Okay, what do we do with the food when it is spoiled or messed up, like too salty or whatever? What do we do with it? Couple of things. If it is possible to fix it, like diluted with water, if it is like some cooking or soup, it happens. You may do that. And it's still possible to consume it, fine. If you cannot tolerate it anymore, and if you have animals which would eat it up, then it's better to throw it to the animals, cattle, chicken, pets. If none of the above, then it is permissible to throw it away, because لا ضرر ولا ضرار. There is no point of eating something which would hurt or harm your health. Okay, and I really sense that your keenness not to be wasteful, not to throw the food away. But hey, whenever you cannot eat it anymore, then you have to get rid of it in a way or another, in one way or another. The third question is, what does a woman do whenever she's working constantly in the kitchen in cleaning up the house, and she has to pray on time as well, and she's not clean? That's the differentiate between the cleanness that you're referring to, that she's not dressed up, she's not wearing the best clothes, she did not take a shower, and the cleanness in a meaning of at-tahara, the purity. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, لا يقبل الله صلاة بغير طهور. So at-tahur or at-tahur refers to the state of purity. The state of purity. At-tahur is the water which is used to lift the major or the minor impurity. At-tahur is the state of purity itself. So as long as you are clean in a sense that you made wudu after maybe a minor impurity, answering the call of nature or whatever, or after ending up the menses, you perform ghusl, this is what's known as tahara. That's why if a mechanic is working and he is closer messed up, and it's a prayer time, a shepherd in the field, a painter, and he made a perfect wudu and he offered the salah is valid 100% because of the state of tahara. The cleanness which you refer to, that you want to change your duty clothes, the clothes which you're cooking in, if you have a chance to do that, that will be great. Especially if you are attending the prayer in a congregation. الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا خُذُوا زِينَتَكُمْ عِنْدَ كُلِّ مَسْجِدٍ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala encourage us to wear our best outfit whenever we go to the masajid and smell good. But at home, especially if you're busy with the youngsters, with the babies, with the cooking and cleaning up, what's really required is the tahara. Most women, they do have a aba'a or an outer garment that they normally wear during the prayer, which will be perfectly fine and that would suit the purpose. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Brother Abu Hanan from United Arab Emirates, assalamu alaikum.
Alaikum salam, Shaykh, how are you?
I'm fine, alhamdulillah, barakallahu feek, Abu Hanan.
Marhaba, Shaykh.
Go ahead if you have any questions.
Sure, my question is, I'm married to a Christian woman.
No.
Okay. And I'm not comfortable because we have a different religion.
No.
And every time I have waswas too much.
Like?
Should I continue? Should I stop? But she's not ready to stop.
Any children?
No, we don't have. The problem is the dressing is my main problem.
I'm sorry, what was that?
The dressing.
The dress, yeah.
Yeah,
how long
the
you been
dressing
married?
Is my main problem.
How long you been married?
2 years.
2 years, okay. I'm glad you called in, Abu Hanan, and let me, if you're done with the question, inshallah, I'll be more than happy to answer this question. You're done. Okay, next. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Brother Saeed from Nigeria. Please try again, Brother Saeed from Nigeria. Abu Hanan is married to a non-Muslim, and he is not too happy. He wants to separate, and he has also the feeling that he may give it another chance to continue. Perhaps she will become a Muslim, and his biggest worry is the way she dresses up. Of course, if she's not a Muslim, she doesn't believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There is nothing to force her or to convince her to wear a proper hijab, right? Because in Islam, the word Islam means submission. You're a Muslim, you submit yourself and your will to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He says, do, then you do. Then he says, abstain, then you must entirely abstain from whatever he ordered you to stay away from. You know, Abu Hanan's call is very important for many of our youth who are about to get married to non-Muslims. And whenever we receive a question, is it permissible to marry to a Christian woman or a Jewish woman, we say, yes, provided she's a chaste woman. What does it mean, a chaste woman? When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَالْمُحْصَنَاتُ مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنَاتِ in Surah Al-Ma'idah, وَالْمُحْصَنَاتُ مِنَ الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْكِتَابَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ يعني, it is lawful for you to marry of the believing women, al-muhsanat, the chaste women, modest, pure women. And also from Ahlul Kitab, wal-muhsanatu, and the chaste women of the people of the book. Chaste, she's a modest woman. She is religiously committed even according to her religion. There is no way in Christianity or Judaism where a woman should reveal her beauty and awrah and walk in the streets with tight jeans or short sleeves or with no sleeves at all, and so on. These people definitely have altered their religion. It was different until 50 years ago. Now it's entirely different, right? So it has nothing to do with the religion. So chastity in Islam and modesty has an inner and outer part. The components of chastity is not only the inner. A person who has been in an illicit relationship with a woman, a non-Muslim woman or a Muslim woman, a non-Muslim from Ahlul Kitab or a Muslim woman. This relationship outside marriage relationship is called adultery, right? If he wants to marry her, it's not permissible, even though he was sleeping with her. Why? Because she's not chaste, neither him. So first they have to make tawbah. A lot of youth, especially those who migrate to the West for residency, for green card, for paperwork, to get a work permit or whatever, he convinces himself that I like this girl, she likes me, and inshallah she will become a Muslim, and I'll go to heaven because of her. What if she doesn't? And what if she conceives And what if you have a couple of kids, whether boys or girls? To me, it doesn't really make any difference. And what if life becomes impossible after having kids and she divorces you and you lose your paperwork and you lose your children and you leave behind children who end up being non-Muslims, as I've met many of them. This is an example. Think before you act. Think thoroughly. Who's going to be the uncle of your children? I'm going to talk to you about your kid's uncle, inshallah, after this phone call. Assalamu alaikum. Islam from Canada.
Hello, brother. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome to the program, Islam.
Thank you. I have two questions.
No.
The first question is that I watched your prophet's prayer, and there you in sujood were supposed to be make supplication as well, and in Surah Araf, in ayat, I think it's 24, Rabbana jalamna anfusana, I'm doing that one, but I'm just a little bit confused that you also said like we in sujood and ruku we cannot directly recite from original like exact verse.
No.
So in that ayat there is a little bit kala at the beginning. So I'm not saying that one. Only saying like Rabbana jalamna anfusana wa illam taghfir lana
wa
tarhamna.
Yeah.
Is that okay?
Absolutely okay, because you can always use the supplications in the Quran, because you are supplicating with them. You're not reciting Quran. It is not permissible to recite Quran neither in ruku' nor in sujood. But to make an invocation using the supplications in the Quran is perfectly fine. Okay?
Okay, just the beginning, I'm not...
The beginning is not included because قَالَ رَبَّنَا ظَلَمْنَا أَنفُسَنَا. They both said, Adam and his wife, they said, Allah is quoting what they said, we've wronged ourselves. And if you do not forgive us and have mercy on us, we will be among the losers. Okay, you won't say that. Rather you say رَبَّنَا without قَالَ. You're not quoting them, rather you are expressing your own invocation. So you don't say qala. In Surah Al-Furqan, وَالَّذِينَ يَقُولُونَ رَبَّنَا هَبْ لَنَا مِنْ أَزْوَاجِنَا وَذُرِّيَّاتِنَا قُرَّةَ أَعْيُنٍ وَجَعَلْنَا لِلْمُتَّقِينَ إِمَامًا. Allah is quoting the condition of عِبَادُ الرَّحْمَن, the servants of the beneficent, that they say in their dua. You don't say, وَالَّذِينَ يَقُولُونَ, because you're not quoting them. You are expressing your own dua. So you say, رَبَّنَا. You begin with رَبَّنَا, our Lord. بارك الله فيك. I almost forgot what I was talking about with Sa'id, with Abu Hanan and his wife. May Allah remind me. Let me take this phone call. Assalamu alaikum. Sister Maryam from Nigeria.
Assalamu alaikum, Sheikh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
How are you, Sheikh?
I'm fine, alhamdulillah wa shukla. Barakallah fiik, Sister Maryam, and thank you for asking.
May Allah bless you and bless the entire staff of Huda Channel.
Same to you. Jazakillahu khayran.
Sheikh, I have two questions, Sheikh.
Please.
My first question is, if a man pays a dowry for a girl,
no,
is he allowed now in Islam to legally have sex with her before the wedding ceremony takes place? Second question is...
Okay, wait a minute. There is a difference between... Maryam. Okay. You mean that they consummated the marriage after the contract or before the marriage contract?
No, if you just paid the dowry. So the wedding fatia will commence later, inshallah. So is he allowed now to have sex with her before the wedding fatia because she has paid the dowry?
She has taken the dowry? She collected the dowry. That means they processed the marriage contract. The guardian gave his daughter or his sister, whomever under his guardianship, to marriage to somebody and collected the dowry and gave it to the bride. Okay? But now they're waiting for the party, for the wedding, right?
Okay. So my second question is, Sheikh, is the istighraf fara'id or is sunnah or mustahab?
What was that? What's sunnah?
Istibra.
Did you say istibra?
Yes, yes.
But istibra is a big word.
Yes.
You cannot say sunnah or mustahab. Al-istibra is a ruling pertaining to a woman who's been in a relationship. Al-istibra is to make sure that she's not pregnant. There is no choice in this regard. If you really mean al-istibra.
Yes, I mean istibra. And what is the timing of the istibra? Is it 1 month, 2 months, or three? Thank you very much.
Yes, you really mean istibra. Okay, thank you, sister. Maryam, barakallahu fiqh. Istibra. Okay. With regards to dukhul, with regards to Brother Abu Hanan's question, I hope this will be an advice, a public advice to all the youth who get married hurriedly before thinking about the future. And I was talking, alhamdulillah, I just remembered that one day when I was teaching plenty of students, Muslims and non-Muslims, and I had the opportunity to marry one of the local girls. I didn't though, because she was Muslim and everything. So I called one of my shuykh. May Allah have mercy on his soul, he passed away. And I asked him, what do you think? So he said, his answer was like that. Well, you need to check on your kids' uncles, whom in the future, your future kids will say to him, uncle, who are they? Who is he? Is he a good person? Is he a Muslim? Is he a practicing Muslim? This word have changed my route entirely and made me think several times before I make the decision. Then I decided, no, I'm not going to go for it. When I thought about it, that my children, when they grow up and they say, I'm going to my grandma's house, who's grandma? And what do they going to see, experience, or live in with their grandparents, crosses everywhere, or dogs and pets, as you all know, having breakfast, pepperoni, having lunch, pizza with pork, with a lot of things. They see their grandparents, their uncles drinking. So I said, you know what? Jazakallahu khayran. This advice changed the course of my life. And now I'm transmitting this advice of my sheikh, which benefited me a great deal, to every person. Forget about your emotions and your heart and your love, because the price is very costly. تنكح المرأة لأربع. A woman may be married for one of four things, or for the four. For the beauty, for the wealth, for the family lineage, for the position, and for the religion, the religious commitment. Not just because she's a Muslim, no, she is a practicing Muslimah. There are a lot of centers which I visited, and sometimes they made certain, they celebrated the Prophet's birthday and this birthday, and you know, these religious, so-called religious celebrations. And wallahi, I have seen women in these centers smoking, wearing very revealing clothes. They walked in front of the musallin in the center, and they were smoking. They won't do that in churches. Christians won't do that in churches. Jews wouldn't do that in their synagogues. So they're very keen to celebrate the Prophet's birthday, but they don't even pray. Furthermore, they don't mind smoking right in front of the door of the masjid. And if any person would dare to tell them, sister, you are in the masjid, not just in the premises, you are inside the prayer hall. put some scarf on or cover up your back or anything. No, they would object to that. So she loves the Prophet, but she does not really love the Prophet. She loves Allah, but she doesn't want to listen to Allah. So when the Prophet ﷺ said, فَظْفَرْ بِذَاتِ الدِّينِ, you will be a winner if you marry or choose, or make your final section, a woman who is religiously committed. If she happens to be rich, belonging to a noble family, beautiful and religious, this is it. This is the ultimate gain. But what if there's only three qualities? Make sure that one of them is religious commitment. Two qualities only, then one of them must be the religious commitment. لِدِينِهَا. What if she doesn't have but only the religious commitment and you're very happy with that? Fine, alhamdulillah, shukrullah. But if three out of the four do not have لِدِينِهَا, then you are a loser. This is what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, فَظْفَرْ بِذَاتِ الدِّينِ تَرِبَتْ يَدَكْ. This, if she is a Muslimah, then I want you to think about. I'm not saying to anything that Allah said it's halal, it's haram. I'm just interpreting the meaning of وَالْمُحْصَنَاتُ مِنَ الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْكِتَابَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ. How does it feel when you walk around with your wife wearing revealing clothes? She doesn't think anything wrong with that. She's been sitting before the mirror wearing makeup and fixing her hair and making sure that the jeans are tight enough because she's going out with you. Are you happy with that? In Islam, you're blameworthy. In Islam, your deen is defected because there is no muru'ah, there is no shyness, there is no responsibility. The man should be protective of his wife. And the woman should understand that when she steps outside her house, she should wear the proper hijab. The minimum, as we discussed before, to cover the entire body except for the face and the hands. If you're going to go to the best, the entire body. But what we see, because they excuse that she is not Muslimah, imagine if in the future you have a daughter, and like mother, like daughter, you see the daughter is walking around like that. What do you think? Is this the child whom you want Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless you with? And do you think this is the child that if you die, they're going to keep praying and in their sujood to say, oh Allah, bless my daddy because he taught me the deen, and he, beware of that. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us to what's best. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم. We'll be back inshallah after the break. Stay tuned. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and welcome back. I believe we only have Sister Maryam's questions. The first one is pertaining having an intimate relationship with a groom, the groom and the bride having an intimate relationship before consummating the marriage officially. Whenever there is a marriage contract, then the couple are already married. She also mentioned the dowry. In case that there is a separation via divorce before consummating the marriage, she will be only eligible for half of the dowry. If the divorce takes place after consummating the marriage, then the entire dowry has become hers and she has full rights. That's why consummating the marriage simply is done via al-ishhar. Al-ishhar is a public party or the walima, or announcing that she is moving in or he's moving in if he's going to live with her or with her family in their house. In order to make sure that publicly announced that these couple are officially married. But this is as far as the customs and as far as the sunnah, the traditions. But if a couple who have already had the marriage contract happen to have an intimate relationship, they are not adulterous or adulterer. No. This is a legitimate relationship, but it is not proper. It should have been done via announcement through the consummating the marriage or the walima or the nikah. She also mentioned listibra. Listibra is a term is normally used whenever a woman, for instance, is being, God forbid, raped, or she was involved in an act of adultery and she repented. In case of rape, this poor woman They didn't have anything to do with it. She's oppressed. And now somebody wants to marry her. How soon can they get married? We use the word listibra to make sure that the womb is free. Al-istibra from bara'a. Bara'a means freedom. So that she's free from any pregnancy due to whether the rape or the illicit relationship. Because if she's pregnant, then guess what? It is not permissible for her to marry. She's got to wait until she drops her load. Even if she is divorced, the iddah is three periods, three courses, or 3 months for a woman who does not have the period. But what if she's pregnant? Then the iddah will be transferred to the longer period, which is أَن يَضَعْنَ حَمْلَهُنْ, to deliver the loads, to give birth. Similarly, if a woman loses her husband, the iddah is 4 months and 10 days. يَتَرَبَّصْنَ بِأَنفُسِهِنَّ أَرْبَعَةَ أَشْهُرٍ وَعَشْرًا. What if the 4 months and 10 days pass and she's still pregnant? Wait until you deliver. You cannot get married. Why? Because there is a baby that belongs to somebody else, whether he's still alive and he divorced you, or the person was involved with you in an illicit relationship outside marriage, or due to divorce. This baby belongs to somebody else. الْوَلَدُ لِلْفَرَاشِ. So you gotta wait. Transform to a longer period. And on the contrary, if a woman is divorced or a woman loses her husband and she delivers the baby next day, then the iddah is over. Why? The whole purpose of the iddah is to make sure that she is not pregnant. So in the case of the two examples I mentioned, we use the term istibra to make sure that she is not pregnant in order to be able to get married. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Brother Saeed from Nigeria, assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullah.
Welcome back, Saeed. Go ahead.
Thank you. Good evening, Sheikh. How are you doing?
I'm fine. Thank you for asking. How about yourself, Brother Saeed?
Now, may Allah preserve you for the Ummah.
Barakallahu feek, ya akhi.
I want to ask a question pertaining the Mawlid Nabi that was celebrated some days back.
Okay.
Some people are basing the fact that if we can have Quranic competition, that means where we have those that have memorized the Quran come together and compete.
Yeah.
These things happened during the time of the Prophet, right?
Continue, please.
Now, so if we can have that in the Muslim society, why don't we also celebrate the Mawlid? That's what they are raising their idea.
Okay. Jazakallah khairan. Barakallahu feek. Naam. Next. Assalamu alaikum. Abu Hanan. Assalamu alaikum.
Assalamu alaikum, Sheikh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. And welcome
back. Earlier, I have asked you a question, and the answer in the beginning of the answer to my question, if I hear you very well, you said the marriage is not valid.
No, I didn't say so.
Okay.
I said Allah said.
Before you answer me, I want just to tell you in case she asks to she become a Muslim. Thank you, Sheikh.
What was the question then?
My question is, if that woman accepts to become a Muslim.
Okay, what is the case if she becomes a Muslim?
Yeah.
Okay, let me make myself very clear. If a woman is a practicing Christian, she is a modest, a chaste Christian, or Jew, as the Quran says, the marriage is valid, okay? The validity of the marriage is not contingent on her becoming Muslim. No, we didn't say so. But we're talking about making the right decision, making the right decision, who's going to be the mother of your children. So now if she wants to become a Muslim, we'll be more than happy, we'll be very delighted if she wants to become a Muslim and you want to keep her. But the answer was pertaining a question you presented earlier when you said that you're confused. You don't know what to do, especially what upsets you the way she dresses up when she goes out with you. So we answered in the light, or I answered in the light of your question. And I elaborated on that because your case is not the only single case. There are hundreds of thousands of cases like that. And I furthermore elaborated on even marrying a Muslim who is not religiously committed. Okay? But the Quran says, وَالْمُحْصَنَاتُ مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنَاتِ وَالْمُحْصَنَاتُ مِنَ الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْكِتَابَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ إِذَا أَتَيْتُمُهُنَا أُجُورَهُنْ. If you give them the dowry, of course. My point here is, who determines whether this marriage is valid or not? You know best, because you know whether this woman was a chaste woman or not. It's not for a person who's sitting behind the cameras to tell about an unseen, because we have no idea. So the answer would be normally delivered in the light of the question. جزاكم الله خيراً أبو حنان. If she wants to become a Muslima, all of us will celebrate that. And as you know, that Islam is a package. Consists of articles of Iman, pillars of Islam, and so on. So it's not just a statement to please somebody. A lot of women, when they come and say, Sheikh, I want to become a Muslim. Just recently I had a girl. Why? She wants to marry. And his family won't accept that unless if she's a Muslima. If it is only the name to please people, it doesn't make any difference. The opposite is true. Whenever it's him who wants to marry, only to get the certificate, he wants to accept Islam so that he will get a certificate of accepting Islam to marry a woman. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Humaira from the KSA. Assalamu
yes, alaikum. Assalamu
alaikum. Wa alaikum assalam wa
rahmatullahi. Assalamu alaikum, Sheikh. I have three small questions.
Naam?
Yes. If only one woman is in masjid, can she join the Jama'ah? And the other is, can children watch cartoons and animated movies? Because I don't allow them, so they just want to know they're watching the show. And one more is, can children apply hair styling gel and make wudu?
Can children do what?
Can children apply hair styling gel on the hair, you know, and make wudu after that?
Okay, what do you have on the hair?
I mean, these days students are just applying the gel.
Gel?
For styling.
Okay. Shukran.
Yeah, that's it. Thank you very much.
You're most welcome. Barakallahu feek. Jazakallahu khair. A woman who's in the masjid, can she pray in jama'ah? She should. If she's really in the masjid and she's in a state of tahara, why not? In this case, she should attend the jama'ah. Children watching cartoons, it depends on what kind of cartoons. Recently, Sheikh Abdurrahman Al-Arifi, may Allah have mercy on him, issued a fatwa, and it's supported also by the great scholar and great scholars in this time, that watching a particular cartoon channel is forbidden. It spreads atheism and disbelief. It's not only about ethics and morals and values, it's talking about also disbelief and rejection of the fact of the presence of Allah and Tawheed at large. So we have to see the contents. I urge the parents as well to watch the cartoons that the children are watching, to know what they're watching and for how much time every day. It's very important. Okay, let me take this call. Sister Katrina from Bulgaria. Assalamu alaikum.
Assalamu alaikum wa
rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
I'm from Bulgaria and from soon I'm Muslima. I'm married for a Muslim man in Egypt. Hello?
I hear you.
Hello?
Yes, Sister Katrina, I hear you.
Excuse me, but I can't hear your voice.
That's okay.
I hope
I hear you. Continue, please. The brother is in the control. Just tell her to continue ask the question. I can hear her perfectly.
Okay. From soon I'm Muslima and I'm married for a Muslim man from Egypt.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And my question is, because we are married from 3 years almost now,
mm-hmm.
but when I get married for him, I was still Christian. And I want to ask, now, do we have to go to Sheikh and to make a blessing for us, something like, you know, for the marriage, like all the people doing when they are getting married, or no?
Okay, Jazakum Allah khair, and thank you, Katrina. Whenever a couple who are already married, let's say the first case, both of them were Christians or Jews, and they accepted Islam, or non-Muslims, and they accepted Islam, do they have to process a new marriage contract? No. What if one of them accepted Islam, then the latter accepted Islam later? Well, if it was during the Iddah period, then they don't have to process a new marriage contract. So you're already married and he was Muslim, and later on you accepted Islam, your marriage is still valid according to the earlier marriage contract, provided the earlier marriage contract was done properly according to the Sharia rules. يعني إجاب قبول in the presence of two male Muslims who are just witnesses. Okay? So in this case, the marriage is valid and you resume your marriage without having to process a new marriage contract or having to go to a sheikh to bless this marriage. Rather, we all join hands and ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless you both and keep you steadfast on his straight path. Sister Humaira, third question, wearing gel over the hair and making wudu. Alhamdulillah, I don't have such problem. Recently, my children started asking about this. So if it leaves some barrier, like it becomes like waterproof, okay? Especially with the youth, they're afraid to mess up their hairstyle. So they touch it from a distance, okay? No, that's not sufficient. وَمْسَحُوا بِرُؤُوسِكُمْ Wipe over your heads. All parts of your heads, with a khilaf, difference of opinions between the fuqaha, whether it's one quarter of the head or it must be the entire head, depending on the definition of the ba' bi ru'usikum, whether it is for at-tab'id, which means some, or wipe over all your heads. In either case, if the hair has some barrier that prevents the water from coming in contact, direct contact with the hair, then must be washed, okay? But a woman who's wearing a hair dye or a henna, that doesn't prevent the water from touching the hair or coming in contact with the hair, and the wudu will be valid in this case. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide all of us to what's best. May Allah have mercy on us, forgive us our sins and pardon us. May Allah teach us what we don't know and help us to act upon what we have learned. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم وصلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.